Welcome to Questions for Christians. My name is Bernie Dehler. I'm an atheist. And today I'm going to talk with Jeff Zweerink. He's a Christian apologist with Reasons to Believe Ministries. In today's format, we're going to have six topics, probably about 8 minutes each. And three of them I chose and three of them he chose. And we haven't really talked about what they're going to be. So we're just going to have a chat off the top of our head. So with that, welcome to the show, Jeff. Again, this is our second show.
Good to be here, Bernie.
I'll give you a minute to explain to the viewers who you are and what you do.
Yeah, my name is Jeff Zweerink. I'm an astrophysicist. I had a PhD in astrophysics from Iowa State University studying high-energy gamma rays. I currently work full-time at a Christian organization called Reasons to Believe that looks at how science and the Christian faith works together. I also work part-time at UCLA doing research on a balloon experiment trying to figure out what the dark matter is.
And you've written some books, and can you explain a little bit about what kind of activity you've had in apologetics? Who have you talked to, et cetera?
Yeah, so one of my contentions is that when we properly interpret the words of Scripture and when we properly interpret creation, they're going to be the same things because they're both revelations from God. And so I have studied numerous different ideas, one of which being the multiverse. First time I encountered that, it seemed like a threat to Christianity. And so I investigated that a lot more deeply and come to the conclusion that the multiverse, whether it exists or not, still fits, makes more sense in a Christian worldview than it does in a naturalist worldview. And so I try to develop resources that help Christians see that science is not the enemy of the faith, and also to see, or to help thinkers see that Christianity is not the enemy of science.
Okay. And just for the viewer, you might notice I've got kind of a weird shirt on. It's like, what is this? And basically it's the, looks like the face of Darwin, and it's made out of a bunch of animals. You can see some elephants and different creatures in there. But, you know, creationists have a origin story about how the universe was created and how animals were created. And as an atheist, you might say we have our own origins myth because we're all trying to find out what's real through science, but nobody really has a 100% view yet. So in a way, everything's a myth because everything is trying to get closer and closer to reality. And How did all the species come about? Well, we have our story about evolution, biological evolution. There's also cosmological evolution to explain how the planets and the stars formed from the Big Bang. So this is just a reminder that there's another origin story out there, and you can learn about both and see which one makes most sense to you. So are you ready to begin?
Yes, let's go.
Okay, so we have three questions each. How about if I start?
Sounds good.
Okay, my first question is, I hear a lot that Christians are saying that science is not the only way of knowing. Have you heard about that, and would you agree with that?
Yes, I think science is a very great way of learning, but I don't think it's the only way that reveals truth.
So what else is there besides that?
Well, I would argue there's historical ways of learning what's going on. There's philosophical ways of learning what's going on. And so there are things that we can determine are true that are not, that don't lend themselves to scientific investigation.
Well, okay. So again, this is where, you know, sometimes people say there's a science versus religion. And I say it's, I say it's better described as scientific thinking versus magical thinking. So when you bring up, you know, there's history as a way of knowing, I would say, well, how do we know what's historically true? And by that, we use scientific thinking, which means you use logic and reason, and you try to come up with the best hypothesis about what happened. So you said history is another way of learning. Well, I would just say that history is basically controlled by the scientific method also, or scientific thinking in general.
Okay. I wouldn't really dispute that, in the sense that there you're putting forth and saying, okay, what's the data here? How do we make the best sense of the data? What's the best conclusion? And using reason and rationality to come about that.
Yeah.
I very much agree that in that sense, I wouldn't really, I guess the question would be, what is scientific thinking as you define it?
Well, so basically, yeah, using logic and reason and facts of the world to try to come up with the best hypothesis. And so, you know, in my mind, when somebody says, well, there's other things, I think what they're implying sometimes, and they're afraid to admit it, is that they're saying, well, you know, basically God told me. That's another way of knowing. That's what I'm thinking is trying to be smuggled in here.
Okay, but would you, I was trying to think how to interact with that, you know, there are books that we have that are written down that, you know, like historical books where somebody just says, hey, this is what happened. I mean, we have no way of knowing whether that event happened except that it's said in a book and then outside of evaluating the credibility of the book.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue that when we're looking at the scripture, that that's basically what we're doing. We're asking, is this a book that is credible and worth listening to, and what does it reveal? And so if that's our definition, I would argue what I'm doing as a Christian in looking for where God's at work is very much in that class of using rationality and logic and trying to discern what's gone on and what's the best explanation.
Right. So I think an important principle here is, I don't know who said this, but basically you should apportion belief to the evidence. So the stronger the evidence, the more you should believe it. So in other words, if somebody came to me and said, hey, look at this holy book I just found, you know, it talks about this civilization that existed prior, you know, it could be the Book of Mormon, whatever. I should not say like, oh, okay, well, I'm going to believe it first until it's disproven. I should just kind of take it as I read it and evaluate what I'm reading to see if it looks reasonable or not. And the more it checks out, the more faith I could put into it if I wanted to. But basically, I had to portion my faith or my belief according to the evidence, right?
No, I would agree. I would just say, you know, I assume you're kind of specifically addressing the Bible there. I think that very process has been applied. And so people have looked and asked the question, okay, is the Bible we're reading today the same as what was recorded, you know, 200 or 2,000 years ago? And there's a lot of manuscript evidence that the Bible we're reading today is the same as the one that was written shortly after Christ lived. And then there's, you know, the question of, is there consistency between the authors as to what they're saying? And so there is a lot of that reason and rationality going in and saying, is this a book that we have reason to listen to? And does it match historically other events that are described? You know, was there a town of Corinth? Was there an apostle or a fellow named Paul who went on these missionary journeys? And mm-hmm. to the extent we establish that sort of evidence, then I think the book is worth listening to, whether it makes claims that seem incredible or not.
So we have a common agreement then that if somebody brings to us a book or anything, we should use logic and all the facts that we know about to judge whether that looks like it's true or not. Is that correct?
Yes, I think I don't think there's ever a place where we ought to just say, well, let's just accept this regardless of what the evidence says.
And what if somebody says, well, I really believe it's true because I get a warm feeling when I read it, and I think that's God telling me that it's true. So I have another way of knowing that you don't have because you're just going on logic and reason, but I'm also going on the feelings of God.
Well, I would be very skeptical of anybody who made that claim personally.
Okay, so because that's one of the things I think that Peter Boghossian, I agree with some of his stuff and I disagree. Have you heard of Peter Boghossian?
I've heard the name, but yeah, again, it's...
He wrote a book called A Manual for Atheists.
Okay.
He's actually local here in Portland. He's a philosophy teacher. And you know, I agree and disagree with some of his stuff, but I think one of the main points he makes is he says that faith is not an epistemology, which means faith is not a way of knowing. You can't say, I know something is true because I have faith. Faith does not tell you what's true or not. Faith is something,
right.
As a Christian, I remember, faith is something you place into something. If you believe it's true, you can place your faith in that, but you can't say you know something by faith, right?
I wholeheartedly agree with what you're saying, yes.
Okay. So when it comes to figuring out what's true, are we in total agreement that the only way to do that is just through logic and evidence and facts? There's no other way? There's nothing else available?
my inclination is to say yes. I hate to make absolute statements like that without having thought about them. But yes, I certainly logic and reason and evidence is, I think that's one of the prime ways of learning about what's true, yes.
Okay.
And so, lacking more in-depth thought about this, I would agree, yes.
All right. So sometimes, I mean, people say science is not the only way of knowing. I guess I agree and disagree. I agree science is not the only way of knowing. It's really trying to say scientific thinking. It's really trying to say science is the endeavor built on logic and building a hypothesis and using evidence. So I think the gist of what they're really trying to say is that scientific thinking is the only way of knowing. And other ways of knowing are wrong. They're logical fallacies. When somebody says, I know this is true because God revealed it to me, sorry, that is wrong. Do you agree with that?
Well, the reason for the hesitation is, I think what I would agree with is that there are effective ways of determining what is true and what is right, and there are ineffective ways of determining what is true and right. And what is true and right doesn't depend on how I come about knowing it. And so, you know, again, I ask you to interpret that comment in the light of the context, or in the context of what I just said, and agreeing with you, is that, you know, if you got a bunch of monkeys typing on a keyboard and they type the statement that gravity goes as 1/r², that's correct whether it was an effective way of doing it or not. But I think there's a great agreement that using rationality and logic and reason and evidence is one of the most effective ways, if not the only way, of determining what's true.
In your personal experience, have you ever really believed something really deep in your heart that it must be true and God revealed it to you and everything, and then as you learn more science or something, you thought, oh my gosh, I was wrong about that? Has that ever happened to you?
Ask the question again, because I'm having trouble grasping exactly.
Basically, a before and after. Was there ever a before where you said, I know this is true because God has revealed it to me so deeply and so clearly, and then later on you learn more facts and evidence and you say, wow, I thought that was true, but now I see it's not true?
I've never had a personal revelation where God's revealing truth to me in that sense. What I have had happen is where I've read scripture and thought it meant a certain thing and believed that, and then come to find out that that wasn't the best way to interpret scripture, or not the only way to interpret scripture. And so, you know, but again, I would, that second line of reasoning is, you know, there's always that looking at all of the evidence, and sometimes I discover new evidence that points me back and says, oh, hey, I need to look at this more carefully. I was looking at things immaturely there.
So sometimes there's a before and after where before you looked at scripture and you thought you had a totally correct 100% interpretation, and then later on you learned some more and you thought, wow, my interpretation was wrong?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll give you an example. Is for a long time, well, for a year or so, I was arguing for young earth creationism because as I looked at scripture and read the data I had to that point, that these were 24-hour days, and that was the only way, that was the best and only way to interpret scripture. And so if that's what scripture said, that's where I was going to live, because I was convinced that scripture was a book worth listening to.
Right. Yeah, I had the same experience. I grew up as a Catholic, and we just kind of viewed the Bible as totally irrelevant to science whatsoever. And then I became a born-again evangelical, and everybody was believing Genesis literally, so I tried to be a young earther and didn't get all the way there. Then I found out about old earth creationism, like your group, and so that was very reasonable to me. And then I accepted evolution and became an evolutionary creationist, and then finally I thought, you know what, everything just makes more sense and you have a naturalistic worldview.
Okay. I would think it would be fascinating at some point to just have a deeper discussion. Kind of curious why all the details there, but I think that may be beyond the scope of the conversation today. So,
well, you know part of it because you used to be a young earther and then you went to old earther, so you know that part.
Yeah, and I think the difference for me is I remember very vividly recognizing that, okay, if young earth creation is true, and the scientific data is true, that means somebody's got to be missing something here. So there's a place where we're missing critical details that help fill in what's going on here. Because I still, at that point in time, and I still do have a conviction that creation is a revelation from God and the Bible's a revelation from God, and when we properly interpret them, they're gonna match. And so it was, as I continued to study, I found a deeper picture of what of how to interpret scripture, because I was still fairly new in my journey there. And I've also studied much more deeply about creation and see that at least as far as the ages of things, there's no real conflict there between what the Bible says and what science finds.
Okay. And so we can go on to the next topic. What question would you have for me?
Yeah, this is a question, largely I'm asking because I haven't had a lot of opportunities to talk to someone who takes a strictly naturalistic perspective, but there's a lot of conversation about, morality and how do you deal with morality in a naturalistic worldview. And I don't want to ask the question is, can a naturalist be moral? Because I think that's a red herring or a rabbit trail, because I think anybody can choose to live morally or not. I guess my question is morality just an agreed upon consensus amongst people, or is it something, or is there things that are truly objectively right or wrong?
Well, so the starting point is, what is morality? So I would give a metaphor. I would say, what is math? Math is all about numbers. What is morality? Well, morality is all about behavior. So, okay, it's about behavior. What about behavior? Well, we have what we call good behavior and bad behavior. Okay, well then what's good and bad mean? So good means what is, what's good for a society as far as like flourishing? What can make a society feel good and live a good life? Those are good things. The bad things are the things that hurt society. So for example, if people went around raping and murdering and stealing, that would really hurt the society. That society would not progress very well. If everybody went around hugging each other, taking care of each other, helping each other, that'd be a very loving society. Everybody would be happy. Their brains would have a lot of serotonin and, everybody would be happy. And that's what people want to do. They want to feel pleasure. They don't want to feel pain. So that's what morality is by definition. Community flourishing, and so obviously there's no need for God in that, because in fact God makes everything worse when somebody brings God into it, because now they're saying this is good or bad. Why? Because God told me. So they're throwing logic out the window. It's all about just God told me, so you better believe me.
Okay, I would disagree with the last part, but I guess the follow-up question I would have, or kind of to probe deeper, is so what is, I mean, I could imagine there are certain people who respond and get serotonin a certain way and others who do different. Is it just what provides the physiological feeling? And how do you navigate where some people are going to agree that this is good and other people won't agree this is good? How do you navigate those? Because we've had different societies throughout history that have taken a very different approach there on what's good, bad, and other.
Yeah, so there's a lot of questions in there. One thing that Sam Harris brought up, which is a really good analogy, he's a an atheist author for a lot of people. I'm trying to remember the book, The Moral Landscape, he's on YouTube and stuff. But he says, sometimes people complain about, what is good for a community, because some people might think it feels good to kill each other, or I like pain, that's good for me, So he would say that, as another metaphor, you look at the health, you can say like, what is health? It's hard to define, but we know what's not health. We know when you're sick with the flu and you're coughing up and you can't go to work because you can't think straight, that's not healthy. And when you got a lot of energy, that's healthy. And so even though we can't really clarify what it is so much, we kind of know what it is, because that's, we got the general outline there. So for example, when you say different people believe different things. So for example, you got Nazi morality in Germany. They, Hitler says the moral thing to do is to kill defective people, like retarded people, and to kill the Jews because they're an inferior race and all that. That was his morality. I would say there's different principles for morality, because my morality is about flourishing society. And so what I've come up with is three principles myself when I look into it. One of them is reciprocity, which means you do what you would want people to do to you. In other words, you don't go around hurting people because you don't want them to hurt you. The other one is consequentialism, where you look ahead and think what might be the outcome and if it's good or bad, flourishing or not. And then the third one is individual rights. In other words, if I think somebody has icky behavior or bad behavior, as long as it doesn't hurt anybody, hurt themselves, then we don't need to make a law about it or anything. You know, we don't need to say it's wrong. Let them do that. Let them have the freedom to do what they want, as long as they're not hurting anybody else and probably hurting themselves. You know, sometimes these clash. Like, for example, somebody might say, like, hey, I want to ride a motorcycle without a helmet. And we might say, like, well, no, I'm sorry, but we have a law here. We're going to make a law. You're going to wear a helmet because we're going to protect you against your own will. And you have to wear a seatbelt, or you have to have health insurance or whatever. So sometimes there's conflicts between some of these things, like individual rights and what's good for the community. So sometimes there are difficult situations like that, but, you know, again, in no way does God come into play on this. And then, you know, the Christian, he might say, like, well, his morality is all based on what God told him or what the prophet said. The prophet said, God told me this, and so we got to follow the prophet. What'd the Pope say? What'd the Mormon president say, you know, et cetera? What did Joseph Smith say, et cetera? What did Moses say, et cetera?
Well, I mean, I got to say, I did find it interesting that your first of your three principles is a very biblical idea of, in fact, all three of them are, I think, is the idea that we want to treat others the way we want to be treated, and that we should think about the consequences of our actions, and, you know, kind of respecting individual rights. I mean, I think there's part of me that wonders is, do you come up with those ideas because you have grown up in a Judeo-Christian worldview where those things have been very valued, whereas had you grown up in a communist society, you would have thought very differently?
Well, for example, reciprocity, where you treat others as you want to be treated. Yeah, Jesus, you know, is famous for saying that, the golden rule, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. But it was a few hundred years before that where Confucius came up with that also. You know, don't do to others what you don't want them to do to you. So I think it's just common sense. When you want to get along, you know, as a parent, when you're raising kids, you're trying to teach people to get along, and it's just kind of like, don't hit your brother. You don't want him to hit you, do you? You know, it just seems natural for, if you want to have a peaceful society, that's what you have to do.
Yeah, just if I got time for a follow-up question, is I guess I'm still kind of curious what, you know, you've talked about wanting a peaceful society or you want people to get along. What is it that determines that that is good? Because I think you can make an argument that societies that flourish and could produce wealth are totalitarian in nature, which don't have those values.
Yeah, so you just said...
Well, go ahead, I'll let you answer.
Okay, well, so what you're doing now is you're putting some different goalposts in there. Like I said, I think it's about community flourishing. So, yeah, you know, part of flourishing is you know, having financial means and all that. But when you start to elevate financial means above human needs, for example, people could say, well, your morality is now out of whack because you're losing sight of what, you know, our goal here is. Our goal here is having a flourishing society. And you know, it's all about behaviors and relationships. And if you start to elevate money up there, then you start to hurt that because people are being selfish and burning other people and all that. Being unfair, basically. And, you know, so basically money cannot come first, otherwise it's going to hurt.
No, I mean, I agree with what you're saying. I find it interesting that the things that you elevate as kind of the supreme goals do seem to fit very much within a Judeo-Christian worldview.
So. Well, I can tell you some moral beliefs I have that are totally opposite of Jesus, for example. Like Jesus, I think, is very clear when he says, turn the other cheek. And, you know, he says, you have heard it say, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, but I tell you, turn the other cheek. And then, yeah, well, you have heard it said, where is that? Well, God commanded that in the Old Testament. And now he's basically changing it. And I think that's the craziest thing ever, to say, turn the other cheek, because if somebody is trying to hurt you, the last thing you want to do is turn the cheek and let them hurt you there again. I mean, number one, you should defend yourself. Number two, try to run away at least. The very last thing is you want to be a doormat and let somebody hit you. And he says if somebody wants to steal from you, give him more. You know, if you give him more than he's asking for, it's like this is not morality. This is kind of victimhood. It's doormat mentality. It's extreme passivism. It's ridiculous. What do you think about that? And then we'll move on.
Yeah, no, I guess my response would be is that I mean, there's nothing in that says to be a doormat. I think it's all in the larger context of, the main thing, or one of the driving principles behind Scripture is that we want to reach out and care for and take care of others. And if it means somebody stealing from you so that they can witness the grace of Christ, then that's more valuable than anything that might happen to you. So,
well, if somebody were to rob you, would you actually give them more than what they're asking for?
Well, I would say the immediate thing I would do is if it were just involved me, I would be trying to ask, okay, God, what are you doing here? And I want to be a part of that. I also have to recognize that part of my role that he has put me in is I'm also a husband and a father, and so things that happen to me also influence my family, and so I'm given a charge of being responsible for them. So I don't think it's a simple, oh, here, just give everybody money as they try and take from you. I think the context gives, there's more subtle, or there's more complexity to it than just that. But.
Okay. It sounds to me, personally, honestly, what I'm thinking is that you're just not, you're basically, the Scripture is too blatant, it's just not smart, and so you're reinterpreting it to make it more reasonable because it's nonsense. That's how I view what you're saying.
Interesting. Okay. That may require more time here to discuss than we have, but that's not what I'm saying.
So. Okay.
But I'll take your words in consideration there.
Okay, so my turn for a question for you. Ready for this one?
Sure.
Okay, I talked to Ken Tovan. Have you seen the show I did with Ken Tovan?
I have not seen that, so
okay.
I have not spent a lot of time paying attention to what Ken Tovan does. So.
Well, we had a topic on morality, and I wanted to bring up, I thought, you know, how can Christians claim to have a high ground on morality when he himself, in his book, he claims to have 3 or 4 doctorates, and he will not even disclose the schools of all these doctorates, but one of them he does. It's Patriot University, I believe, is the name of it. And it's obviously a diploma mill. They don't even have a faculty. There's 0 teaching staff.
Right.
And I talked to Fazel Rana, who works with you, about this on our TV show. And, you know, he agreed that there's some kind of problem there. Mm-hmm. I talked to another apologist on this TV show, just the last one prior to this, and he was saying, well, I don't really want to go there. I don't want to talk about that. And so basically my question here or topic is, should we be able to address what we think is wrong and within our own camps? Like, for example, should Christians say, like, you know, Kent Hovind, shame on you for having a fake degree. I will talk about it. I will not paper it over just because he's a Christian and I'm a Christian. And I'll give you an example. As an atheist, I believe that, you know, we should also be clear on our own camp. For example, Christopher Hitchens wrote that book called God is Not Great, How Religion Poisons Everything. I personally think that's ridiculous to say religion poisons everything. One time I talked to Dan Barker, who's a well-known atheist, in a debate, and I said, you know, isn't that kind of a crazy title? And he wanted to defend it, which I could not believe. And then even Christopher Hitchens, when asked about it, will defend it. You know, I thought Christopher Hitchens would say, like, well, you know, that was just a provocative title to sell it, because personally, I think who would buy a book if it wasn't that provocative? I don't know if they'd buy anything from Christopher Hitchens. Maybe he's just being that provocative just to sell books. But he really says, you know, I really do believe it. It poisons everything. And I think that's ridiculous to say religion poisons everything. So what do you have to say about this topic about, should Christians be more willing to clean their own house and atheists and all that?
I would agree. I mean, I think that there's a lot of stuff that happens, or there's a lot of things that Christians do that is reprehensible. And, you know, what I see, the struggle I wrestle with in this, and that I think probably plays out in the larger Christian community, is there's a tendency to focus on one attribute of God to the extent of the others, and we focus on God's grace, that, you know, God forgives, and I think we have there's often a poor understanding of that you know, there are behaviors that are just, they, you know, as you mentioned, it detracts from Christianity because people see them as just wrong, and it seems like nobody's calling them out. Now, I think part of what makes that conversation difficult to have is that you can also look at times through even American history, and if you go into other places, where that let's go out and call everything out turns into a quick legalism that is also very stifling. And so I think there's part of that that's just a real struggle for Christians to live out. But I do very much agree with you that as a community, that as Christians, we ought to be pretty intentional about calling out bad behavior and dealing with it, because if we don't, it just, one, it perpetuates itself, and two, it damages the gospel. I mean, I think, you know, in some sense, I think you're very right to look and say, you know, wow, these Christians, they don't seem to value honesty and integrity. Why should I want to listen to what they have to say?
Yeah, I'll give you another example. When I was an evangelical Christian, I was basically had a part-time ministry where I preached the gospel on the internet and this local TV. And at one point, I was thinking about starting a church also. And just as far as ministry, I wanted to find out what would be good salaries, for example, or good pay. And so I looked up and looked at all the ministries. And you can look up on the internet to find out, I think it's called GuideStar, where you can see their forms. And I actually went through all the ministries and plotted salaries. And one thing that popped out at me was John Hagee, for example. He was like paid over $1 million a year. And I looked into it, and basically it was really crazy how, I mean, most Christian ministries, they do not overpay like that. It was just a really big standout. And I thought he should be confronted. I even made an online petition, and I tried to show other Christians, look, we need to go after this guy to let him know this is not right. And I even had a seminary professor about it, because I was attending seminary, Baptist seminary, and he was saying, like, well, you know, so many of them, almost all of them, especially the evangelical ones who really care about evangelism, it's like, well, don't say anything, don't do anything, God will, you know, he'll have to answer to God. And my seminary professor even said, like, well, you know, you can look in the Bible and it talks about the gifts of the Spirit, and nowhere in there is about correcting a brother. And that just struck me as odd, because it's like, we should be standing for the truth, and teaching is a gift. And
yeah,
I just thought it was really strange how it's so hard to have reform, it seemed like.
I have to say, I'm sympathetic to your position there, because, you know, it doesn't, I guess I would say this, as I've read through the New Testament, what you see as the qualifications for being a leader in the church are pretty high, and I think it's just for this reason, is that, one, it's difficult to correct very popular leaders, and so you need to have people who are more about God than they are about themselves. And, you know, I think what, you know, in part what we see is where we've relaxed those standards and criteria, you see the egregious behavior, you know, there's somebody who made a comment, you know, Christianity's not so bad, it's the Christians I have problems with. And so, you know, in all of what I'm saying, I also think it's important to realize that it's very easy to err on the other side of being so there. If you go about rooting out bad behavior, there's also a very strong tendency to become very legalistic and to miss that God is gracious. And so, but it's not to excuse it. I'm just saying I'm sympathetic to your position, and I think, especially for leaders in ministry, leaders in the church, where you're called to a much higher standard because it has big ramifications.
Yeah, some of these evangelical churches, they want to be really big, I think, and so they don't want any controversy. So I can see a pastor of a mega church not wanting to say anything about, you know, John Hagee, because what if he's got a bunch of people in the audience who love him and they're going to leave the church? And for that same reason, they don't really want to get into details. From my experience, because I went to a lot of different evangelical churches, Bible-based churches, the bigger the church, probably the less they want to talk about origins, for example, like the young earth creationism versus old earth creationism versus evolution, because they know if people are going to argue about it, it's going to be divisive. And so they say, let's not argue it. But then the whole intelligence, the whole IQ of the congregation goes down because they're afraid to talk about it.
Yeah, I mean, I know just personally from my experience and preferences, I actually really enjoy having a lot of those difficult, kind of challenging discussions and exploring where do we go. Because you know, there's a lot of things that I have doubts about, and so the way to address doubts is to have open and honest conversations about them. But you know, I mean, I'd love to say Christians are just completely different, but there is, you know, Christians are have a propensity to sin just like everyone else, and so I'm like I said, I'm sympathetic to your position there. So
now I wonder if you're really facing that problem head on, because, like I said, it's my belief or my experience that evangelical Christians, especially in a huge church, do not want to talk about origins because there's so many different camps and it can get divisive. And yet you're in a ministry that, you know, that's the core, one of the core things is you're trying to teach the science and the origins. So it sounds like what you're doing is, and you would like to go into churches to educate Christians. So I could see a natural situation where they want to shut the door on you. Do you kind of see that?
That's happened at times, yeah. That, you know, there's been places that because of the position I hold, it's just not acceptable to have the conversation around. And so, you know, and I think one of the things I try very strongly to do, and I actually enjoy having people, you know, in some sense enjoy having people with a contradictory viewpoint, because it helps me sharpen and be more representative in what I say, is I think it's just very important that we deal honestly with things and that we're not afraid to deal with the truth, whether it's uncomfortable or not. And so I think that's, I think that's going to start happening more and more in the church, because it's less comfortable in the church.
So do you, I mean, even overlooking the fact that you have a specific interpretation, it seems like there's a bigger issue of you're trying to breach a topic that's kind of taboo, you know, the origin stuff. It's just kind of a taboo thing because it could be seen as divisive.
No, there are places where where the conversation, they just don't want the conversation to happen. You know, I mean, part of what we do as a ministry is that we go and look where people are receptive and willing to listen. But I think critical in that is making sure you're open and honest about what your position is and what its strengths and weaknesses are, and helping people understand.
Do you think that's getting easier or more difficult as time happens?
Sorry, what's that?
Is it getting easier or more difficult to breach these topics in big churches?
I think in ways it's easier because there are a few large churches that have done it, and that makes it easier. And then I think other places it gets harder too. I mean, you know, there's a lot of pressures on pastors, and you know, part of me is sympathetic in the sense that if it's not a big issue in the congregation, there may be other things that are more important to deal with. And so I think there are reasons why at times it's not the biggest issue or necessary to address. But I do think sometimes it happens that it just doesn't get addressed because it's going to be difficult to deal with. But I have seen a number of pastors that are willing to stand up and deal with it in spite of the challenges and difficulties that come up. So,
okay. Ready for the next topic?
Sure. And this, again, kind of goes, or most of mine kind of center around, you know, physical material things, but, and we had a little bit of a discussion in this in a previous program. My question is, why can I think about the universe, but it can't think about me? And kind of what I'm getting at there is, it seems like consciousness is, or our ability to think and think beyond the physical material world is, doesn't fit well in a situation where the physical material world is all that exists.
I don't understand why you're drawing that conclusion. I don't understand why couldn't nature create, do you see there's a possibility that nature, let's say for example, nature just created life and created ants and stopped right there. Could you see that? Or, because there's no consciousness, human consciousness at that point. Could you see that okay? Or is that part of the problem?
I think at least from a material standpoint, that makes a lot more sense because you're not dealing with any sort of thought that transcends the material world. So okay. Yeah, this question would be irrelevant if humans didn't exist.
Okay, well, so the only difference is once you get ants, the only difference there is degree. That's the only thing. There's nothing special about humans. We have a mind like all the other animals. It's just that our mind is more complex because our brain's more complex.
So the response is that this is just the natural progression of how physical things work.
Yes.
Okay. Does it at all seem odd to you that lacking anything beyond the physical, we can think about things that aren't physical?
Well, let me back up a little bit. So, you know, I said that you said you don't have a problem with just like, you know, progressing up to the point of ants. But if you go and let's say you progress up to the point of chimps, bonobos too, you don't have a problem with that either. It's just the human mind.
Well, I think, you know, specifically about thinking about the universe, that there's this thinking completely outside of ourselves. What if things were very different? I do think...
Because I'm thinking that the human is not that huge of a step from a chimp.
Why would you say that?
Because they have so many... We can see so many rudimentary signs of everything, like they can hunt, they have a rudimentary language, they have rudimentary morals. There's a guy named Franz de Waal who wrote a book called Primates and Philosophers about rudimentary morality, signs of morality. It's very hard to find. In fact, humans don't have anything unique whatsoever unless you say, oh, well, they worship God. As far as you know, that's it. I mean, we got music, animals have music. We've got dancing, animals dance. We've got humor, animals have humor. It's just a small step, it seems like, to get to humans from other animals.
Okay, so I'm not extensively studied in the philosophy, but I know that there are some philosophers out there, like Thomas Nagel would be an example of one, who argue that any sort of naturalistic mechanisms to explain consciousness are just inherently flawed. And so I think he argues that consciousness is just built into the universe.
I have no idea what that means.
Well, I think the term I've heard for it is panpsychism, that consciousness isn't something that arises from the physical. It's actually an inherent property of the universe.
I mean, how would he say humans get consciousness? I mean, if it's not from the brain, where does it come from?
He's saying that, as I understand, the brain is maybe a physical medium associated with what we think, but just explaining the brain doesn't explain the consciousness as well, that the consciousness is something
Okay. Well, I'm sorry I interrupted you.
I'm sorry
I interrupted you. So you can go back to your main flow there of what you were leading up to, I think.
Yeah, I guess the question I would have is if it were shown through neurobiology that getting human consciousness is something that is not purely physical, would that be evidence of a creator or a supernatural in your book?
Well, we know that other animals have consciousness. I mean, we know that chimps have consciousness. Consciousness just means being aware of your surroundings, being conscious.
I guess I would define consciousness as not just being aware of your surroundings, but also being aware to think about you and think about things other than you.
Well, what if a child is retarded and they don't ever think about that stuff? Are they conscious?
One, I think we'd be hard-pressed to say that they don't think about that, but no, I would say that doesn't mean they're not conscious. Consciousness is bestowed on humanity, and so if you're part of the human race, you have that. That would be my contention there.
So you're saying that, like, chimps are not conscious?
Not in the same way humans are.
Well, not in the same way, of course. And humans have different levels of consciousness. I mean, sometimes they say, let's elevate the consciousness, because some people contemplate things, and some people just kind of go on, according to the rat race, they don't think. So people have different levels of consciousness.
Well, I think the difference that I would argue is maybe a little bit more of, or is more of kind, not of degree, is that, you know, we think about, you know, differential calculus and how do you describe the universe and what's going on and what if it were different, I don't think any animal has that sort of consciousness besides humanity.
Well, let's say, for example, a person is on drugs and it's hard to even think of anything. All they're doing is just thinking, like, wow, I got bliss, you know, I just feel good, and that's all they're thinking, like, oh, I'm out in the sun, and I feel these rays, I feel so good, and that's all they can think about. Are they conscious without thinking about, you know, God and death and all that stuff?
Yeah, because there's a difference between, you know, doing things to blunt the ability to think and not having that ability at all. And I think that's the distinction, is that, you know, as humans, we all have that capacity, whereas no, as far as we can tell, primate or dog or anything has that capacity to think about, why am I here today? What's my purpose? That's not what animals seem to think, but that's a very natural way for humans to think.
I don't see any problem there. I just think because of our complex brains, because we have language, we probably wouldn't have these complex thoughts if we didn't have language. But because of language, though, we can share what's inside of our head and say, what do you think about this? Oh, I never thought about that. And then what about this? Oh, yeah, let's put two and two together, and now we got this. So, because of language, we have a huge boost, I think.
Okay, like I said, I was just kind of more asking that. I was just curious how you would respond to that. So that is one thing I think fits, I think, as I assess it, I think it fits more comfortably in a Christian worldview, but that's why I wanted to hear how you would respond.
Okay, I would say in the big picture is I think the humanity is, like I said, it's not that big of a jump from bonobos and chimps. I think it's fascinating is that with evolution, the next stage is going to be machine life. It's called mimetic evolution, where basically the evolution of ideas. And I think we're going to, you know, if you look 100 years from now or even 1,000 years from now, I don't believe Jesus is coming back, you know, like a lot of Christians, you know, think tomorrow or whatever. So I think we may be around for another million years or so. And when you look a couple hundred years in advance, I think machine life is going to overtake biological life. And I mean, we're going to be like stupid Neanderthals compared to how brilliant the computers are and their awareness, and they're going to have their own language. So that's how I kind of see things.
Well, I do know that experiment will be performed and we'll see which is the answer. I think we disagree on what the outcome is going to be there. So.
Okay, ready for another topic?
Yes.
Okay, so this last two we'll do just like about 4 minutes or so.
Okay,
so my question for you is about Noah's Ark. I think it's kind of interesting because, like I said, sometimes these topics are taboo in the Christian church, especially big church, because there's so many different ideas and they don't want people fighting about this. And sometimes I ask apologists this, and I'm surprised that sometimes, like, I think Fazil Rana, you know, at Reasons to Believe, I think even he said, like, well, you know, I'm not a theologian. And I'm thinking, do you need to be a theologian to understand this story? I mean, why is this story so complicated? Is it a worldwide flood? Is it a local flood? Or is it a myth? Those are three main positions. And some apologists, like this other guy I talked about, he went to seminary, a different guy, it's like they say, well, they want to punt on it by saying they're not a theologian. So I'm thinking, why is this such a complicated question? I mean, it's a Bible story. How could anybody who's in the pew understand this when a person with a seminary degree says, you know, they don't think they're a theologian enough to understand it. I don't get it.
Well, I mean, I guess I know what I would say is that I'm not a theologian enough to give a explanation that satisfactorily answers every question I have about it. So as I look at it, you know, do I see it as a historical account? Yes. So I don't think it's a mythological account, that there was a real flood, that there was a boat that saved humanity and the animals from judgment, that was an outgrowth of how evil the world had become, and that was God's judgment on the humanity. Now, in every one of those, you know, the question is it global, you know, as in covered the whole globe, or is it local in that it didn't cover the whole globe? And then there's a question of did it cover all of humanity or not? In every one of those, there are, you know, theological and interpretational and scientific questions, and there's data that weighs in on all of those, and it's difficult to find a way that reconciles all of that. And if you're going to argue that it's mythological, there's also textual difficulties with that. And so I think it's a reflection of the obvious aspect of the story is that God was judging humanity because of how evil and depraved they had become, and he was saving a certain segment of the population, and it was about that, about how much God hates sin. Now, when you get into the details of how exactly did this work, that's where it gets a little more complicated. And again, I would say I can tell you what my position is, but I also know there are questions in there that I don't have good answers to in my position. So,
well, I can maybe think that, you know, if a person like the evolutionary creationist who says the Bible doesn't say anything about science or, you know, or whatever, you know, somebody who says it's basically a myth, it's just to teach theology, I could see somebody saying that, and then there's no conflict because it wasn't meant to be a literal story. So how can you have a conflict then?
But that, like I said, there are textual difficulties because if that's myth, is Abraham myth? There's no place where you transition from the mythological stories to the actual historical stories. And so, you know, from a textually, how do you interpret scriptural consistently? That raises some problems.
I think they basically would just say, look at the whole Bible as, just don't go to it for history. I mean, you know, the big picture, and this is why I couldn't stay in it anymore, but basically the big picture is, you know, that you're a sinner and Jesus came and died on the cross for your sins. And if you believe that, you're going to have eternal life and go to heaven and, you know, serve the Lord and don't worry about all the details. I don't know. I guess for me and maybe for you, you're saying no, I'm sorry. The Bible is obvious. It's trying to tell a story here. And it sounds like this person who says it's a myth just isn't, they're compromising too much.
Well, and it's, I wouldn't say it's compromising. As I look at how the structure of Genesis is laid out, to say that the flood is a myth, then you have problems with, is Abraham a myth, and is the Exodus a myth? And there are all these things. It's like there's no place where that the textual clues would say, oh, this is myth and this is history. And so it presents some textual interpretational difficulties to just declare it a myth.
Okay. Last one, you have a short question for me?
Yeah, and kind of the nature of the question is, does your view kind of reduce to a determinism? And the way I worded the question, and this is not to be snarky, but it says, you know, if the natural universe is all there is, why do atheists and agnostics want to convince me of that? Because isn't just what I think just a outgrowth of the neurons that are firing in my brain? And if it's just kind of a physical process, why would they be concerned about what I think one way or the other?
Okay, so I think there's one logical problem you have there is you're saying because it's a physical process, therefore it's all determined. I guess those don't really equate. I think that, for example, when I was an I have an electronics degree and we learned about op amps, you have a feedback circuit. So some of the output comes back to the input. So with our minds, we have a feedback circuit also where we have input coming in, and based on that input, we can have a different output. So I would say, you know, we basically, in some ways, I guess a good analogy is a computer or a Google driving car. For example, a self-driving car, you can say, go to point A to point B. Okay, so it's going to go. And if the road's blocked, it's going to make a calculation and say, okay, I will go around this way or go left or right, step on the gas, put on the brake, whatever, to avoid an accident. But there's feedback there, and it's making decisions based on all these inputs. And we're doing the same exact thing. We're looking at all these inputs and making decisions. So as we share ideas, that's what all we're doing. I'm giving you feedback, you're giving me feedback. And we're just looking at this feedback and making decisions based on it.
But I mean, even in your Google car, given a knowledge of the conditions, you'll know exactly what the car does. So given the knowledge of the feedback and how my brain is wired, what actual choice do I have to make as to what's going on? Isn't it all just a reflection of the particular state my brain is in?
Well, the Google car, I mean, everything's going to change based on the inputs of what's happening, though. I mean, like, for example, one Google car can go through the road and then the tree falls down. The next Google car has to wait and go around it or whatever. So, you know, maybe conceptually, if you knew the future in every exact moment, you could calculate it. Probably so, because if every atom is under control, but there's no way we would have computational power to know every neuron at every second and everything and all the feedbacks and everything that's going to happen in the future. Basically, we don't know what tree is going to fall when, so you have to go through life to find out what's going to happen. But so can you maybe close in 15 seconds because we're out of time now?
Yeah, I guess I would just, you know, it's still a open question in my mind. How, if the physical world is all there is, we have this capacity to transcend that in our thoughts and say we have decisions. But I've enjoyed, it's been interesting and helpful to listen to your responses, and so it helps me understand your position better, so I appreciate that.
All right, and thanks for coming on the show. I really appreciate that, too.
All right, thanks. Have a good evening, Bernie.
Okay.